has had a wonderful week. It's great to be back in worship with you today. I offer thanks and praise to God for each and every one of you who is able to join us. We're also still going to continue our Facebook Live broadcasts. So welcome to anybody who is watching us from home and on Facebook. You are just as much a part of this worship service as anyone. And so we offer thanks and praise for each and every person who is able to join us. No matter how you join us, we are grateful that you are here as we seek to glorify God together. We begin our time together with some announcements. As we begin the transition back to regular worship, we're going to be putting the bulletins online again. So those folks who are watching Facebook Live, you can download the bulletin if you want to follow along with the bulletin. I don't know that we're going to be continuing with the screen. If you have passionate feelings one way or another, make sure you talk to me or a member of Session. Deacons and Session are both meeting this week, as is the PNC. If you know of any graduates, please be sure to let me know. We definitely, I want to honor what is happening in the young people's lives. And so if you have anybody who has graduated from college or from high school in 2020 or 2021, we're going to be acknowledging those graduates. So please make sure you give us their names, and you can send me a text or leave it on my desk or even call the church or call me, whatever works. And Jane, the food bank distribution is going on this Tuesday, right?
Yes.
Yeah, that's a food bank distribution. It's hands-on mission where we go and pass out boxes of food to people. It is done through the Allegheny County Food Bank. It happens at Pittsburgh Mills. Jane Smith is organizing that. And so if you are interested in participating, it's a really nice thing to do. You get to meet a lot of different people just as you're passing stuff out, as well as the people who are coming through. Jane will tell you what you need to do in order to participate in that way. And it's a big week in the life of Union Church, right? Because we have the rummage sale, and Donna's going to talk to us about that.
Good morning. We have a lot of things downstairs already, but we will be here tomorrow most of the day, probably from 10 until 8 in the evening. And through, it's okay, Carol. and through the week, we'll be here from quarter after 11 until probably 4 or 5. If you need me to be here later in the evening, just let me know. Wednesday evening we'll be here with the session, so the door will be open then. But we do not want to take anything after Thursday at noon, because we need time to get things priced and ready to go. Thank you for all your donations that we have already, and thank you in advance for your help.
Thanks for organizing, Donna. Are there any other announcements in the life of the church for this week? Okay, I don't see anybody waving frantically, which means I must have managed to get everything. So, okay, so we've made it. Here we are. Let's take a deep breath. As we gather for worship, let us prepare our hearts and our minds.
Thank you.
stand for the call to worship. The voice of the Lord is upon the waters. The glory of the Lord thunders. The Lord is upon the mighty waters.
The voice of the Lord is a powerful voice. The voice of the Lord is a voice of splendor. Let us worship the Lord our God.
Let us pray. Creator God, whose spirit moved over the waters, who gathers the seas into their places and directs the courses of the rivers, who sends rain upon the earth that it should bring forth life, we praise you for the gift of water. Create in us such a sense of wonder and delight in this and all your gifts that we might receive them with gratitude, care for them with love, and generously share them with all of your creatures. We pray in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Offers. Let's say together the prayer of confession. Oh God, we know that
Jesus offers like living water, but time and time again we turn away from things that don't satisfy. We know that in the waters of baptism you have made and claimed us, but we fail to claim your ways and your fruit. In repentance we ask you to forgive us. Set us
died to the old life and a new life has begun. God's grace is poured out upon us day by day. And so as we enter into the summer months, remember your baptism. Be thankful as we say together the good news of the gospel. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Know this and be at peace. You may be seated. It's time for a special time for children, and we are continuing to do the children's sermons even when we don't have children in the sanctuary, in case there are some watching us on our live stream. And so you may see a picture here. I'll need a little help from adults today. What's going on in this picture? Yeah, a little child is watering the flowers. And this is a reminder for us that we need God to grow. So a lot of us have to have drinks of water. We need our love from our parents. There's so many things that we need to grow up to be big and strong. Water is one of them. God's love and Jesus are another one. And so my message for the children today is there are a lot of things that you need. Just like that flower needs water to grow, you need the love of Jesus to grow and to be strong and to live a full and rich life. Let's pray. Lord, we give thanks for the children that you have entrusted to our care and pray that you will continue to water and nurture them as they grow, that they will grow strong in faith. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. First of all, I want to offer some thanks. We have different people doing our AV system today, from the sound to the Facebook Live to the projection. So thanks to everyone who has stepped in and is doing something a little bit different. It can be a little bit nerve-wracking to do that, and so I'm very grateful for all of you who have done that. Also, I forgot to thank everybody who came to the workday yesterday, and what a beautiful job they have done. Making the front of the church look so much nicer with all of the weed pulling and the mulching. And it was a great day. It was a joyous day in God's creation. And our summer sermon series is going to be about water. It's called Come to the Waters. And it is our first scripture is the story of creation and stewardship and how we are called to be part of this earth and this garden that God has created. Last summer, with the pandemic, my kids moved back into the house. They're both in their 20s, and it ended up being a hot, dry summer. I don't know if you all remember that. And we ended up having to ration our water, or the well would have run dry. As it stood, we ended up with, you know, getting some brown water if too many people did laundry and things like that. And we ended up watering our flowers from the well that was down at the barn. Other years we've had the opposite problem, as in too much water, because our basement sometimes has a tendency to flood as well. And maybe we ended up just like this church did several years ago, with a ton of water in the basement that then you have to pump out and clean up. And that's the thing about water here in Western Pennsylvania. We don't think about it until it runs out or we have too much. We can be, our stewardship of water does not require a lot of thought for us, because most of the time we have enough. Water, though, is a force of nature, and having the right amount of water is key to our survival. We can't live without it, but we also can't live in it with too much of it. But our lives are dependent on water, and as you heard Caleb reading the story of the creation from Genesis 2, it's God adding water to the earth. In the Bible, water is a part of the story from the beginning to the end. Literally, God sends the rain in Genesis 2, and we use water for baptism and other things. Water's part of our spiritual lives, and we're going to be concluding the sermon series by going to Loyal Hannah for a remembrance of baptism, as well as doing some boating. And somebody said, what is a remembrance of baptism? We only need to be baptized once. That is part of our polity. We don't need to be baptized multiple times. But if you have been baptized and would like to come to Loyal Hannah, we'll talk about the meaning of baptism. We'll have a liturgy where we say some things and have an opportunity to touch the water and remember our baptism. And then after that, we'll do some kayaking. And if you know anybody who would like to be baptized, we may be able to do a baptism there. I'm not sure. That's a session decision. But this will be a time where we gather at the water together, both for refreshment and joy and a spiritual experience there at the water. Religions around the world have seen water as sacred. And Christianity is no exception. Judaism is no exception. Because without water, we don't have life. As you may remember, water is one of the first things mentioned in the Bible. Genesis 1:2 says that the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep. And the wind of God swept over the face of the waters. This passage reminds us that we are living between the water and the sky, the waters of the earth and the sky. God separates them and creates land. God hovers over that watery chaos, saying, let there be a dome in the midst of the waters. Let the waters separate between the earth and the sky. And then in Genesis 2, you heard the waters of creation are coming up out of the earth to water the earth and to cause things to grow. There's also a lot of other water stories, many of which I'm sure you know, Noah and the flood. Ezekiel has visions of water flowing out of the temple. John the Baptist baptized in water. Jesus offers a Samaritan woman living water after she gets a drink of water for him. And how about Peter? You remember that story about Peter? What does he do? He walks on water very briefly, but Jesus walks on water. Jesus calms the waves of the water. And then finally, in the book of Revelation, in an echo of the story of creation in Genesis, we see a river of life flowing through the New Jerusalem. And we're going to explore a lot of those stories this summer, but today we're just at the beginning. We're at the very beginning of the Bible when we see the tie between water and creation and abundant life. In Genesis 2, there is nothing but dry ground. There are no plants, there's no Garden of Eden, because the Lord God had not caused the rain to come upon the earth, and there was no one to cultivate the earth. But then verse 6 tells us a mist or a stream comes up out of the earth to water the ground. After bringing forth water from dry land, God creates Adam out of the dust. And then God plants the Garden of Eden, and the earth becomes populated with plants and trees, and that's where Adam is placed. So the water wells up, and then it flows out of Eden in rivers that divide into four branches. And when we look at the stories of water in Genesis, the first starts with an abundance of water covering everything, And that water needs to be tamed and the land, the water separated to reveal the land. In the first one, there's too much water. It's covering everything. And the other story begins in the dust that needs water to thrive because there's not enough water. And of course, God provides both the taming of the chaotic waters and the provision of the needed water to sustain life. It's like our world today, right? There are some places that have a lot of water, and there are some places where water is very scarce. Or it could be like for us here in Western Pennsylvania, a different summer. Some is so wet, it floods, and sometimes it's so dry, we run out of water. And it's not surprising that the Bible would have both of these views of water, because even though Israel itself is about the size of New Jersey, you can go from the beach, the big water, the beaches of the Mediterranean Sea, to the dusty desert of the Negev in just a few hours. Rainfall in Israel can come so fast and furious that it fills riverbeds and causes flash flooding. And we know about biblical stories of flooding, right? In our Bible story today, God creates Eden and puts Adam in the garden to work and take care of it, presumably managing the water as well. Because managing water and the stewardship of creation is something that you and I have in common with Adam. Whether it's our own well that serves our house, or we are protecting that water that is being provided as city water. We, as Adam's descendants, have put on God's big earth, God's Eden, and we're responsible for working it and for taking care of it. We are stewards or managers of creation, and that means we're stewards of water. And stewarding water is something that humans have done throughout history. Stewardship of water can look like building dams and dikes to keep land dry in the Netherlands or in New Orleans. Or it can mean finding ways for a woman in sub-Saharan Africa to not have to carry 44 pounds of water several miles for her family. Stewardship can mean finding creative ways to conserve water in the desert or picking up trash along rivers or beaches. It can mean stopping businesses or individuals from dumping toxic chemicals into our water, or it could be creating a new company to find ways to provide clean water or take junk out of the ocean. In much of Israel, water is something that people think about and fight about, because they are stewardships of just a little bit of water that they have. Streams get diverted from some communities and countries to be used by others. That happens here in the United States, out west, too. There are even rules about who's allowed to collect the rainwater that falls on their roof and what they're allowed to do with it. We see over and over and over again that in the Bible, water is life and new life. And what happens to the water will eventually happen to us. So today is a stewardship sermon. We all love a stewardship sermon, right? Usually we think about it as, well, she's gonna tell us what to do with our money. That is not the case today. But because we have to think about the earth that God has created and entrusted to us, and the idea of stewardship is the same. How do we use our time? How do we use our talent? How do we use our treasure with regard to water? Big water, like oceans, and small water, like the water in our wells. First, let's talk a little bit about the oceans. The polluting of the oceans is a problem worldwide. It can result in human health problems, poison wildlife, and damage to the ecosystem. Our Eden is very interconnected. What happens to the water of the oceans actually can have an impact on what happens to us. And one of the biggest challenges in the ocean is plastic. We, as a culture, have migrated to a plastic culture. Think about it, even in my own lifetime, I've gone from paper grocery bags to plastic. Microwave and takeout food comes in plastic. We used to buy berries in those like green cardboard boxes. Anybody remember those? Yeah? Now we buy them in plastic. There's dental floss picks, disposable razors, we use body gel instead of bars of soap. That's all plastic. Soda or pop that used to be in glass bottles is now in plastic. Baby toys that used to be wood are now plastic. And I'm not saying this, you know, this is not me scolding you, because you come to my house, you're going to find a lot of plastic. But I was just thinking, we have migrated into so much plastic use over the years that we may not even realize how much we're using. And every year, humans throw about 8 million metric tons of plastic into the ocean. Here in the United States, we do a little bit better than other countries, but some of it gets recycled, but not all of it. So if you think about it, it's one garbage truck of plastic goes into the ocean every minute. If we carry on as usual, this will increase to 2 per minute by 2030, 4 per minute by 2050, and that means by 2050 there's going to be more plastic in the ocean than fish. And maybe you've seen photos of those plastic bags and bottles littering beaches, or heard about there's plastic islands floating in the Pacific Ocean. There's one between California and Hawaii that is the size of Texas. We're far from the ocean, though, so why do we worry? What does it matter? Again, God's creation is interconnected. What happens to the water does have an influence on us. The air we breathe is dependent on the oceans functioning well. 50% of the world's oxygen comes from the ocean. The oxygen stores more carbon dioxide than our atmosphere. And it's easy not to think about what ends up in our ocean since we're so far away. But in addition to impacting the atmosphere, the ocean provides tangible things like salmon and cod for our dinners, medicines for cancer and Alzheimer's and arthritis. In non-COVID times, the ocean-related businesses are $282 billion in our U.S. economy, and 3 million Americans work in ocean-related businesses. So stewardship of our big water, of the ocean, is important, even here in Western Pennsylvania. Because think about it, what would we do during Lent if we couldn't have a fish fry, right? Or couldn't go to a fish fry? We need cod and the fish that come from the oceans. Where would we go for vacation if the shores all end up littered with plastic? The best way we can be good stewards of big water is the way we can be good disciples. Just try to do something a little bit differently. Make a small change in your daily habit. During Lent, we think about, oh, I'm going to pray more, I'm going to read the Bible more, you know, things like that. Maybe in our lives, to be a good steward of water, you think, well, I'm going to use bar soap instead of shower gel, or not use disposable razors, whatever. You know, to be a good steward, we can just pick one little thing, because if we all do one little thing, it begins to add up. In addition to thinking about water in the big sense, like oceans, we're stewards of water in smaller ways, of rivers and streams and wells. Most of us can turn on the tap and take a drink or a shower, and we don't think about it. But do you know what's in your water? If you have a well like I do, you get it tested every so often, and sometimes you're surprised at what you might find in your water. But we're lucky in that most of us live in a place where the water we drink doesn't make us sick. Worldwide, 1 in 9 people do not have access to clean and safe drinking water. That's a lot of people. Some of those people are in developing countries like South America or Africa, but some of them are in the U.S. They're being serviced by lead pipes that create a problem, or they're like the Oregon-California border. They're a place where there is drought. So we're stewards of our local water systems, too. How many people remember the Orange Creeks from the coal mining? I see a lot of hands up. My grandmother lived in Export, and there is a, you know, that was a coal patch for a while, and there was a big Orange Creek that ran through there. But over time, people have worked to clean it up, and it's not that bright fluorescent orange that you're a little bit afraid of anymore. I ride my bike at Roaring Run on a regular basis, so if you know the Kiskaminetus, you know for a while it was, what, a dead river. We've done a great job of people working really hard to bring it back to life with remediation for some of the runoff and adding fish. And so we can be good stewards because we can help the water that is in our area. And we can make it usable and for recreation, for use. And I'm just going to say this. I was driving in to work this morning past the stream. I swear I saw a beaver. But do groundhogs swim? So whatever it was, I was like, oh, look at the life in that stream right there. And I just felt like, you know, this is a sign of, you know, look at what is happening in the water. I will also tell you, when I was pregnant with my second child, I had some abnormal test results. And there was a heron that stood in that stream at the bottom. And every time I drove home from work, if that heron was in that stream, I was convinced that my baby was okay. Strange things, right? We all look for God where we can find it, and to me, God is so much a part of creation. So we need these living, breathing streams of water, and we need healthy water, because water is a gift from God, and we are called to be good stewards. We're good stewards. We want to be good stewards of the ocean, even though it feels far away. We want to be good stewards of the rivers and streams that are right here near us. But we're also called to be good stewards of water for other people. Matthew 25, Jesus says, people who didn't give him anything to drink when he was thirsty, those are the people that go to eternal torment. And those people who do offer him a drink, those are the people who get eternal reward. Giving people to access to water is important in big and small ways. There are a lot of Christian groups that is what they do. They make sure people can drink water. They drill wells and install water purification systems in other countries and in troubled cities around here. They give the world's poorest and most at-risk people something to drink literally. But we're also called to be stewards of small water. Drinks of water. And I remember the time when my grandmother was in the hospital. She was very near the end, and many of you may have had this experience as well. The doctors say, don't give her anything to drink. She might aspirate it. And all she wanted was a drink. She just wanted some water. And so we had a sponge on a stick that you dip in the water, and you rub it on. That's being a good steward of water, too. It is giving someone not just the water, but the love and the care that Jesus offers us in water in a very small way. But that stick and that sponge of water are representative of the streams, of the oceans, and of the way that God works and flows throughout the earth. Jesus links himself to water in a spiritual and a symbolic sense. Whoever believes in me, Jesus says, will have rivers of living water flow from within them. Like that river that flows through Eden, water brings life and joy and growth and love. What happens to the water happens to us. If we're dry and dusty spiritually, Jesus' living water is not going to flow from us. If our hearts and spirits are polluted, Jesus' living water won't flow out of us. If we're careless with creation, Jesus' living water or good water won't be flowing within or around us at all. The waters of creation, the waters of our ocean, the rivers, the wells, the water on a sponge at a hospital, they are all interconnected. They are a symbol of God's love flowing around us. So when we care for the ocean, we're showing our love and respect for God's creation and God's people. When we keep our rivers and wells clean or provide water for our neighbors and our children, we're letting God's love flow through that action. And when we provide that drink for someone who is thirsty, we are sharing the love of Christ, the living water who has come for all the world. What happens to the water matters in our physical and our spiritual lives. Our lives can be dry and dusty, but if we just add water, if we just add that water of Jesus Christ, the living water that he brings, we can become fruitful and we can reflect what that Eden is for the world. We can be flowering and full of leaves and full of fruit when we just add Jesus' living water. Let us pray. Lord, we give thanks for your creation, for the water that sustains life. May we be good stewards of the water, making sure that all your people have something to drink and enough water to sustain not just their lives, but their spirits. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Come now to our time of prayer where we pray for God's people, God's world, and whatever is on your heart, whatever brings you joy, whatever is concerning you, we'll leave some silence for you to lift up your own personal joys and concerns as well. Let us pray. Living water, river of life, font of hope, Lord, receive our praise. For wind and for rain, for creatures and trees, for hot and cold, for the lifeblood of the earth, and for our yearning that this creation you have made will thrive, that your waters be whole and clean, blue and green, growing what is needed, immersing us for lives of thanksgiving. God of mercy. Lord, we pray for those who don't have access to clean and safe water. Bless those whose missions it is to drill wells and help communities that struggle to have clean drinking water, both here in the U.S. and abroad. God of mercy. Lord, we pray for the farmers and food producers who are so dependent on water. Lord, may you bless them for the work that they do for us and for all of those who eat and partake of the bounty of your creation. We pray, Lord, that they will have enough water. God of mercy. Lord, we pray for the safety of people who vacation at the beach or in water or who go fishing. We pray that the waters will be welcoming and restorative for them. God of mercy. Lord, we pray for the stream that runs through this church property. And we pray for your church here at Union, for the pastor nominating committee, for the session and the deacons as they seek to lead with vision and to fulfill your will. God of mercy. Lord, we pray for the leaders in our community. May they do your will. Guide their decisions so that they may show love for neighbors. God of mercy. Lord, we pray for those who are facing grief, especially that is new and raw. We remember the Holmes family, the Couts family, the Young family, and those others who have lost loved ones in these past few months. Lord, we know that grief has no timetable, and remember those who are still facing the disbelief that their loved one is gone. We pray for them during the lonely evenings, the wish that things had been different, and all the things that come up as darkness descends. God of mercy. Lord, we continue to pray for those who are in need of your care. We lift up Molly and Steve. We pray for Jeff and Carol. We lift up those who have been written on our prayer concerns, including Joe and Bill and Sharon. We pray for Christian, for Donna and family, for Regina and Marcy. We pray for Carol and John. We pray for Doreen and Kim. God of mercy. Lord, we lift up Carly and Samantha and Victoria and the babies that they are carrying. We pray for their partners and families as they seek to support them. God of mercy. Lord, we pray for those who can't be with us, for Kathy and Lois, for Claire, for Walt, for Pat, for Helen, for Sherry. Lord, we pray that your presence will surround them and your peace be with them. God of mercy. And Lord, we lift up those who we name before you now. Lord, there are so many in need of your care, but you are a great big God. And we pray your presence, your power, and your healing, and your compassion with all of those named here today. God of mercy. And we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
We take this time to give thanks for the offering. Lord, we seek to be good stewards of all that you have given us, and really and truly everything that we have, the ground that we stand on, the water we drink, the jobs we have, the money that we get, all belongs to you. So we return these gifts to you with glory and honor, and pray that they will work toward the betterment of your kingdom here on earth. Amen. As we go out, let us take with us the living water that can refresh, restore, and heal. Let us be the living examples of Christ Jesus in the world. And as we close today, we're going to sing our amens instead of say them. You ready?